Narupaya Vishvot Patyadi Hetave Tapatraya Vinashaya Shri Krishnaya Vayam Numaha Hariyam. Who is presenting today?
Huh?
Karam.
So Agastya Rishi, the lineage is Brahma, Marichi, Kashyap and Surya. So regarding the birth of Agastya Rishi, there is a story. The son of Ikshvaku Raja was Nini. He wanted to do a sacrifice and invited Rishi Vashisht, but he was busy. So he called Shatanand, the son of Gautam Rishi. So Vashisht cursed Nini. And Nimi cursed Vashisht back. So, Vashisht's spirit left the body and started roaming in the sky. Then he prayed to Brahmaji to grant him a wish that he should, and Brahmaji granted him a wish that he will be born again from Mitra and Varuna. Now, Mitra and Varuna were one body, so Vashisht's spirit entered that body. They saw Urvashi and embraced Urvashi, and the spirit of Vashisht enters Urvashi's body. So, then Mitra and Varuna separate themselves. So they were one body, now they separate themselves. So now they get, one of them approaches, which is, Varuna approaches Urvashi, but she rejects him, but she accepts Mitra. So, anyway, the fluid was kept in a pot by both of them, and that then were born Rishi Agastya and Rishi Vashishtha. They were also known as Maitra Varunis. Maitra Varunis. Agastya Rishi was well versed in the Vedas and the sciences and science of diverse weapons. Agnivesh, the teacher of Guru Drona, was a disciple of Rishi Agastya. Agastya Rishi had brought all passions under control. So one day he was walking in the forest and he saw the Pitrus hanging upside down, the ancestors. Also, Agastya Rishi was very dwarfish in height. He was short and he was bearded. So the Pitrus told him that if you give us a son, when you have a son only, then we will be allowed to enter heaven. So now he had to marry, because to get a son he had to marry. So, what did I do? The king of Vidharva was wanting to have a child. So he was doing great penance. So Agastya Rishi went to him. And he blessed him, and then he created, out of all the whatever was available there, he created a girl called Lopa Mudra, and he gave it to the king of Vidarbha. And then he asked for her hand. The king was very reluctant to give her in hand, but Lopa Mudra agreed, and they married. Now, how they had the son? This is an interesting story.
King wanted to.
No. King of Vidarbha.
Child.
Yeah. Lopa Mudra. He created Lopa Mudra and he asked her hand.
But Swami, he created Lopa Mudra. That's what.
But this word is written. Okay. So then the king was relented, but she willingly agreed to be his wife. And Agastya married her. The marriage took place at Mahasindhu Tirtha. After which they went to Gangadwar. Now there is another story of how Agastya ate Vatapi. Okay.
And what happened to them?
So they got married and they got settled.
What a son, what happened to
them? No, wo baad mein aayega. Yeah. Snehi, to have the son, this story is coming.
Oh.
Yeah. So Lopa Mudra had all this thing. She was very demanding. So she told him that I want you in a particular fashion. You come to me, only then this thing will happen. So for that he needed a lot of money. So he went to, he approached Shrutarva, Bradhanaswa and Trasyadasyu for money. They were three kings. He approached them for money. But they all said, "Hamara khajana dekh lo khali hai. We don't have any money." Then he went to an asur called Ilval. And Ilval had a brother called Vatapi. Okay. So, ye dono jo hain, inko brahmano se bahut dushmani thi. Because Ilval had asked one of the Brahmins for a son having the power and status of Indra, and the Brahmin refused, so unko Brahmano se dushmani ho gai. So they considered them enemies. So Vatapi was converted into a goat, killed and fed to the Brahmin. They would bring the Brahmin home, Vatapi ko goat banake usko khila dete the, and then Ilval would say, "Vatapi, Vatapi, come out." Then he would break the stomach of the Brahmin and come out. Okay? But this is there in Ayurveda also. This Vata is from this Vatapi only. Okay? So now they tried the same thing with Agastya Rishi. So what Agastya Rishi did, he ate the Vatapi and then he digested him. So he couldn't come out. Okay? So then Ilval had to give him all the wealth. He gave him some 10,000 cows and same amount of gold and all. So then Agastya Rishi went to Lopa Mudra with all that. And then they had a son. His name was Dhridashyu or Idmavaha. Idmavaha, why? Because he used to gather twigs for his sacrificial fire for his father. And his son chanted Vedas on birth. So this story is now over. Obviously, the Pitrus went to heaven. Now, the story of how he stamped Vindhya Mountain down. So, Vindhya Mountain is one of the mountains in between north and south of India. So, the mountain started growing very high, started troubling the sun and the moon. And nobody could stop it. So, Agastya Rishi was approached and then he went there. And then he, as soon as Agastya Rishi ko dekha, Vindhya Mountain started shivering. You know, and he said, he started coming down. So Agastya Rishi told him, "Ki bhaiya, tum abhi idhar hi raho, main south ja raha hun, I'm going to south. Till I don't come back, you cannot rise up." So he went to the Malyachal in the south and he never went back. Agastya Rishi never went back. So Vindhya Mountain could not, this thing. As he made the mountain is called Aga, bow its head, so also the name Agastya. Okay, now Nahush was a king. He was transformed into a serpent by Agastya. This is in the Bhagwatam story. I'm just taking in short, Swamiji. Devraj Indra killed Vrittasur. Devraj Indra killed Vrittasur, who and incurred Brahmahatya. So he went and hid in a lotus at Manas Saras. It's written here. Is it Manas Sarovar? Okay. So Manas Saras, in the shape of a water snake, Krishna, Indra went and hid over there. Now Nahush, who had taken over the Swargalok, he started eyeing Indra's wife. It's very funny. So she told him that, okay, if you want to come to me, you have to come in a palki, which hermits are going to carry. Hermits have to carry that palki. Now, Agastya was one of the bearers of that palki and he was short. Remember I told you? So, he ordered them. He was so impatient to reach there. He ordered them to walk faster. So, he said sarpa sarpa. Some word he used was sarpa sarpa. Means walk fast, walk fast. So, Agastya Rishi cursed Nahush. And he said, "You turn into a huge serpent and fall into the great forest." So he turned into a huge serpent and fell into the great forest. And he would be relieved when Dharmaputra, means Yudhishthir, will meet him. So that story is there. Now there is a very famous story about Agastya Rishi that he drank up the ocean. So again, Indra killed Vrittasur with the help of Kalakeyas, who hid at the bottom of the ocean. And they would come out at night and eat the Brahmins, so they could not be killed unless the ocean was dried up. So Agastya was called and he drank up the ocean. Okay. Then Vishnu, so they wanted the water back, the Kalakeyas were killed. So Vishnu said, when Bhagiratha brings Ganga to the earth, the ocean will be refilled. Also, Agastya Rishi cursed Marich and Tadaka. Marich and Tadaka in Ramayana. Remember when Vishwamitra comes to take Ram and Lakshman to the forest to save them. So he cursed Marich and Tadaka. I'm not going into the detail. Also, very important story is of the Gajendra Moksha. The Gajendra Moksha. The Indra Dyumna was cursed by Agastya to become an elephant. And Deval Rishi cursed Huhu, who was a Gandharv, to become a crocodile. And now we know the story of how the Gajendra Moksha happened. So the crocodile caught the leg of the elephant, and then he prayed to Lord Vishnu, and Vishnu came with a Sudarshan and this thing. Then a few very short points. Agastya Rishi taught Sri Ram Aditya Hriday Mantra before the war with Ravan. The slant of the earth was rectified by seating Agastya. For some reason, in Shiv and Parvati's wedding, the earth ka slant shift ho gaya tha. To Agastya Rishi ko ek side bithane se wo normalize ho gaya tha. Agastya and the Kronch Mountain. Agastya and the river Kaveri. This is just short points I'm saying. Agastya in the palace of Bhadrashwar.
No, this is Bhadrashwar. I didn't take a lot of points, you know. I'll just take these last important points. Okay.
Agastya Rishi also cursed Urvashi, Jayanta and Narad. Agastya Rishi cursed Duspanya. And how Agastya Rishi got a golden bangle. Agastya's brother, younger brother, and his disciple was Sutishna. Sutishna was the person Ram and Lakshman met in the forest, if we know about Ramayana. When Rama returned to Ayodhya, one of the visiting Rishis was Agastya Rishi. When Rama returned to Ayodhya, he had given Ram an arrow to pierce a demon's heart, come out of the other side, go to the sea, bathe in the sea water and return to the quiver. It was given by Agastya Rishi. Tamil language is presented by Rishi Agastya. Some of his compositions are Agastya Gita, Agastya Samhita, Siva Samhita, Dvaidh Nirmay. I've tried to shorten it. I mean, and I also have Rishi Angira. He was a hermit born from the mind of Brahma, Manas Putra. A very important story which is there in the Bhagavad is about the king Chitraketu. He was childless. He had many queens. So he blesses the king that he will have a son. His wife Pritadyuti gives birth to a son. The other wives are jealous and kill the child. This story is there in the Upanishad Ganga also. The other wives are jealous and kill the child. So the Chitraketu is, you know, distraught and he's devastated. Itne mein Angira Rishi arrives there with Narad and he agrees to call the child back to life. Okay, so instantly call the spirit of the dead child, asking it to become the child of the king again. The spirit replied it had large number of parents in previous births, so it could not become the son of the king and vanished. After which, the king became a devotee of Vishnu, but was cursed by Parvati to be reborn as Vrittasur. Now we saw Vrittasur in Agastya, right? So it was Chitraketu who was cursed to become Vrittasur. Angira cursed Sudarshan to be a serpent, and this liberation was done by Lord Krishna in the Ras Leela. While the Ras Leela was happening, a big serpent came and nobody could kill him except Krishna. He had 5 wives, 7 sons, 8 daughters. Now another story. Prahlada's son, Prahlad, Bhakt Prahlada's son Virochan and Angira's son Sudhanva loved the same woman. So they asked Prahlad, who is greater? Now Prahlad goes to Rishi Kashyap to clear the doubt. And Rishi Kashyap says that Sudhanva is greater, not Virochan. He was also known as Atharva Angira because he chanted the Atharva Veda. Angira Rishi advised Rishi Drona to stop the fight in the Mahabharata. In the Mahabharata, he went to Rishi Drona and said, "Bahut ho gaya, now you stop fighting." He gave sermon to Gautam on merits of holy places. He gave sermon to Gautam Rishi on the merits of holy places. Daksha, the Prajapati's two daughters were married to Angira. Angira once saved a son. While the Pandavas were in exile, Angira was chanting and meditating in Alaknanda. While the Pandavas were in exile. When the hermit stole the lotus of Agastya, Angira gave some hints about the culprits. He gave a discourse on fasting and the merits of fasting. Also gave a discourse on the secret of duties, dharma. Once he drank the water in the ocean to the last drop. I don't know why they drink the ocean. He created new springs of water and drank them dry. He cursed Agni, and since then smoke started coming out of fire. Okay. Conducted many sacrifices for King Avikshit. Angira has also blessed Dhruva, Bhakta Dhruva. Indra gave him a boon. Indra was born as son of Angira's called Savya. Son of Brahma in the Swayambhu Manvantar, but in the Vaivaswat he was the son of Agni, Angira's. I hope we know the Manvantars, right? Angira taught philosophy to Saunak Rishi. Now in the Bhagavat Saunak Rishi, he taught philosophy to Saunak Rishi.
So just point wise, it was very
Virochan is
that same. Indra and Virochan story. Same.
So how did he get Brahma Hatya by killing Asur.
They need not be Asur only because of lineage. No, like Ravan was a Brahman. He is born in the Pulasthi Rishi's Kula. Same way, Vritrasur also will have a lineage. Check in that book. Vritrasur ka lineage hoga. So if you kill a Brahman, then you will have a Brahmahatya dosh.
What is the purpose of how do you actually drink up the ocean?
Are we are talking only about what we know as history. How much old is Himalaya? Not even 5,000 years old. It is the youngest mountain range.
My question.
Puranic eras we are talking about, and so many, our history only is some 5-7,000 years old history. Itna chutka sa hamara history hai. Human being has existed for millions of years. So there must be some time geographically when the mountain must have been huge, continuously growing. Matlab what? How? Even today, Himalayas are growing, by the way. Himalayas are constantly growing because of the tectonic changes happening below the earth. So now millions of years, so many things could have happened. They would have put it poetically saying it was troubling earth and when the sun and the moon. Obviously it cannot trouble sun and the moon. But it is like, okay, it's huge. It's growing, growing, growing. And so then he comes on this side. Maybe tectonic changes or whatever else would have stopped by that time. So the mountain stopped growing. That is one possibility. Now, if we want to explain it in a so-called logical way that we think and we understand. But we should also remember a few things here. That power of mind that they had is much more than what power of mind that you and I have today. It's very small. What we have, our power of mind is chutkasa power we have. These people have done tapasya. They have managed to control.
You know that what tapasya they have done, how they have realized and everything.
They could be written, but they would not write exact vidhi and everything. And at a point in time, it is what? You remember the Lord, you get all powers. What?
That's right, but they should describe that.
You open the books and read, na? There are lots of tapasyas written. Utna to kare hum pehle.
Not for us. What?
Of course, they would have written that in some places, but they would not have... It would not have got saved or whatever. A lot of our culture has got destroyed and a lot will always be there. And certain things they will not write. Why should common man know that? Because the mind will not be pure enough. It will misuse it. You see, nuclear power today is there in so many people's hands. It's very dangerous actually. So some things they may not have written also. Like this Bala and Atibala. These are two vidyas that Vishwamitra Rishi taught with Bhagwan Ram and Lakshman. Hunger and thirst they will not have. Sleep they will not be affected by. Those kind of things are there by which they will not go through any of these hunger, thirst, sleep deprivation, any of that. Now the description of that will not be there in that. They may want to keep it Gupta, no? They may want to keep it as a thing which only an adhikari can get. So that is also possible. So their mind powers are tremendous. So through sankalpa also many things happen. And another thing we should know is that these are not just physical beings. Now, he is born as a manasputra also. So when they say manasputra, then they have much more powers. Brahmaji is manasputra. Like Manu and Shatrupa are manasputra. Naraji is manasputra. Like that they are manasputra, then they have much more powers than ordinary human beings will have. And this whole creation itself is a sankalpa, no? The whole creation itself is sankalpa of Brahmaji. So the laws that you and I know are very limited. If in the mind of Brahmaji he decides that Vindhya mountain has to grow to this height, that's all. That is all it requires, that Vindhya mountain will start growing. And if Agastya Rishi decides that when I cross it, Vindhya mountain should not grow, then it will not grow. Because that is Jada Vastu. And here it is the mind power which is much more subtler. Mind also is Jada in that sense, but much more subtler power. So the power of Sankalpa is much more. That is one thing that I can learn from the story. Because even as a child we have learned all these stories that he crossed. And one more thing with this story is that the integration of North and South happens very clearly. Agastya Rishi settles down in the south only. And as they said, you know, his Tamil language and all that. So Sanskrit, Tamil, so much conflict they're going on today also with that Sanskrit and Tamil and all that. And this division between North and South that has been created by people. As a country, we did not have that kind of a division at all. In Mahabharata, you see Arjuna has gone to Manipur. He has one of his wife, Ulupi, is from there. Northeast also he has gone to west and everywhere, down south, all the places. So many kings have fought in the Mahabharata war from the South India. But we don't know only any of that. If we read the Mahabharata, we will know, okay, this is what it is. So that way the integration of North and South also happens. Now why do they drink up the ocean? The ocean, because you see, below the ocean there are a lot of these creatures like that Kalakeya demons, they are all staying below. Now if you want to destroy them, to fight them, you cannot fight them below the ocean. They are much more powerful below the ocean. So you have to deprive them of that and then destroy. So they will drink it up for certain reasons like that. And as I said, because they are manasaputras, they will have lots of power. It's just like in your dream, you can dry up the whole ocean. Because you are the creator of the dream. You can dry up the entire ocean and who will prevent? Because you only are the ocean also.
But Swamiji, these stories are also to be taken at face value, or are they like the Puranas, where there's a lot of other meaning also?
Other meaning also, no? That's why I said some of the other meaning just now. You cannot take only at face value, because at face value some of them will sound very, very absurd. Okay, what is all this, you know? See, some of this will be a leela and some of this will be on the path to realization. Like Vishwamitra Rishi is a realized person, but he went through another challenge from a king, Kaushik Raja, to Vishwamitra. What was his transformation? What was his struggle? In that he fell for Menaka. So it's a part of the process. Either it will be a part of the process where one will struggle, go through it, overcome it, or it will be doing it for the sake of a leela. If he is able to create a woman only, where is the question of him having lust? So it won't be out of lust. And now he did not create a woman biologically from him. So creator can always fall in love with his creation. Brahmaji has married Saraswati. In one of the versions, Brahmaji is married Saraswati. The principle is creator can fall in love with the creation. That we keep seeing everywhere.
But for a reason, Swami.
Here it is for a reason. And here it will be some karmic connections which will be there. Otherwise, he could marry any girl. No? If he wants just a son, he could marry any woman. But he has to create someone. There will be connection of that Raja's karma and those other people and those three kings and then this Vatapi and Ilvala and all of them. There will be some karmic connection in all these. And that's why these Manasaputras will have all this knowledge. Like Naradji also will know. So he goes, na Shivji Parvati, how he makes them marry. He only goes to Himavan Raja and Maina Rani and he tells them, Are, she has done tapasya earlier, she was Sati and the whole thing. So they will know. Manasaputras have that power that they know the creation, past, present, future. Now keeping that in mind, they will do certain things. So these stories, that's why Gurudev used to say that first read Vedant, get clarity on Vedant, then come to Purana. Because Purana, if you read just like that, you will say Hindu culture is all, you know, can't believe all this, it's all useless and some fake stories some people have just created.
It's clear. No, even if they don't feel fake, one is not able to, it's very difficult to
relate.
But Swamiji, it's like this, it's significant, Swamiji.
Now you see, tell me, Harry Potter you can see, na? Six movies of Harry Potter you will see and wizard and witchcraft and this and that. One minute. So it's fictional, but you are deriving lessons out of it or not? There are workshops being done on that and people derive lessons and huge things. What is the main objective? That's the main objective. From these stories you can derive whatever are the lessons.
And if a small child asks how a child is born, for a small child, it's this thing, na, unbelievable for the small child, how the baby can come out. But as they grow up, you realize, na, so humare ko bhi aise hi abhi lag raha hai, yeah, how this is
and
possible.
And once you go deeper into the stories, yeah, you get to connect the dots.
Yeah, you can connect the dots and certain things we won't understand with today's knowledge.
Yeah.
We have to accept, yeah, at that time they could have had some of those things and some of those things will be, as I said, they are mental powers. They need not be only at the gross level. Their capabilities are much, much more subtler than us. So then it would be possible for quite a lot of them. Agastya Rishi, that's why it's called Kumbhaj Rishi. He is born from the pot. He and Vasishtha are born from the pot. So Maitra Varuni. Mitra and Varuna, so they are called Maitra and Varuni, the children of Mitra and Varuna. Right, anyone else? Those of you who are new, these are the rishis about whom we read in the Bhagavatam, in the first canto. That all these rishis came to listen to actually comfort our Parikshit Raja. But then Shukadeva Maharaj also comes there and then Bhagavat he will start. So they all have, when Shukadeva Maharaj comes, they all get up, they receive him, they welcome him. So all these names which were there, so we gave the class members, 1, 1, 2, 2 rishis, to do some research based on a book called Puranic Encyclopedia. Not from internet. Internet has all kinds of information available. The Puranic Encyclopedia at least has references. This story referenced in this scripture from this is where it is. And it's amazing how the genealogy is given and what all records they have kept. We think our culture is not very well documented, but it is quite documented quite well in certain areas. In some areas, of course, it could have been better. So, some of these rishis are what they are sharing with you.
Swamiji, this Indrapramada, he is not mentioned in the encyclopedic, in the Puranic encyclopedia. So, should I go ahead a little bit? So, he is, it's not there, but in the internet is what I found that he's mentioned in Canto 1, Chapter 9 of Bhagavatam, which we have done. So he was present at the time when Bhishma Pitama was giving up his body. So he's mentioned as one of the rishis over there. So obviously he was a very great rishi, because otherwise he would have not been mentioned also. The other thing is that only other reference that I could find is that he's a Gotra rishi. So the highest level of classification is the Sapt rishis. Then below them comes the Gana rishis. And these Ganas are derived from the seven Sapt rishis. That is Bhrigu, Angirasa, Kashyap, Atri, Vashishta, Agastya and Vishwamitra. Then each Gana is further subdivided into Gotras. And then the Gotra has several Pravaras. I don't know how to pronounce it.
Gana and Pravara.
Pravara. So Pravara means most excellent. And so a particular Brahmin's descent comes from a Pravara. Now the reason for giving this background is that Indrapramada is from the Gotra of Vashishta Rishi. So he is a celebrated Rishi. But nothing else is known.
What is the reference? You said chapter 1?
Canto 1, chapter 9, verse 6 and 7.
Canto 1, chapter 9.
Yeah, I checked it. It's here only. We've gone through it. Yeah.
So what is the mention? That's how we finish, na, Canto 1.
Yeah.
Yeah.
From 4.
Chapter 9, verse 6 and 7. From 4.
Parvata Narada Dhamya Badarayana Bhradashva Bharadwar Pasuram Vasishta.
No, we are looking at Indrapramada.
Yeah, yeah, I'm seeing that only. Pasuram with his pupils.
Vasishta,
Indrapramada.
That Vishnu
says. Asita Kakshivan Gautama Atri Vishwamitra Sudarshana. Brahmarata. Shukadeva is called Brahmarata. Vishnurata is he. So Brahmarata. Kashyapa Angira Samadha Sarabhita Prithi. Anyone else?
No, I'm not done. Who is there?
What is the name of the Rishi?
Kavasha Rishi.
K-A-V-A-S-H.
Kavash.
Kavash.
You had said
Kisarimon Ganguly is verse by verse translation. There are four huge volumes, such fat books. Literal verse by verse translation without any comments or anything added. But Kavash Rishi, what was the source? Why are we searching in Mahabharata?
Because in the Puranic Encyclopedia, it referred to, there was one line on him, two chapters. Is there in Sabha Parva and Shanti?
Oh, good. So then we at least know Sabha Parva and Shanti Parva is there in that. Then one can find. Sometimes the spelling is another thing and we have to search. We'll see. Kisarimon Ganguly, we have the book. The PDF will be there. We'll check.
So I'll look again on the book. So I
No, that's fine, but the soft copy of K.M. Ganguly's translation, if you search, no, in PDF, they will have PDF files.
Yeah, there is PDF, but there are sections, not chapters, and the relative, that same number, you see 208 or chapter 7, it's a summary, it's not a,
That's what, so verse by verse will be there, and it's possible that there may not be anything much about that rishi also, possible. It's just like this one, like, a reference is there, like that the reference may just be there in Mahabharata, may not be much.
You don't want the story from the net.
Yeah. From the net, find out what story it is, but I don't know. Ha, to batai, aay ke batai. Kavash.
Yeah, so this is, there are two highlights to this story. One is that your Varna should not be by birth. Mani, he was born to a maid, Ilusha, and so he's a Shudra, but he attains Rishihood. And the second thing is that self-effort is everything. So you can change your destiny by doing your tapas and prayers. And so,
keep the mic closer, otherwise nothing will get recorded. Recording may work, yeah. Oh, that's
okay. So the story of Kavash Ilusha highlights two facts. Self-effort can overcome all odds. Of course, grace of God is needed. Caste or Varna was not immutable. A person born of a Shudra can be elevated to a Rishi. Kavash was born to Ilusha and he wasted his life in gambling dens, neglecting his family, mother, wife and two children. One day he lost everything. Dejected, not unlike Yudhishthira. Dejected was returning home when he came across his son lying unconscious outside a forest. Kavash felt great remorse that the child had gone probably to find fruit for his family, but his body just gave up. So then from that moment, he turned over a new leaf and he worked for a living and served society also. However, maybe he got some ego or arrogance. And one day he saw a yajna was being performed by a group of rishis on the banks of river Saraswati. And he joined the crowd. Now, though he is not a rishi and he is not qualified to sit over there. So, but the rishis took objection and they evicted him from there because of his caste. Now, there are two versions of the story. One, Kavasha Rishi points out the body of Rishi Aitreya lying close, says, am I below or above the status of the body of the Rishi? He is the Rishi who presided over many such yajnas. So now the other Rishis, they got the message that the Atman within all is the same. But the body will disintegrate into five elements. So they included him into Rishihood. And then he wrote five hymns. And those are there in Rig Veda Mandal 10, hymn 30 to 34. Then the other version is longer, and the second version says that where he was forcibly evicted was very far from the river, and there was no source of water, and no, it was totally deserted. Now he had no support. So he did a lot of tapas, and he did a lot of penance, and he prayed to Lord Varuna. And Lord Varuna was pleased, and the river Saraswati started circumambulating that area, and the land became fertile. And the rishis heard about it, that group of rishis who had evicted him, and they came to fetch him. And then he became a rishi, and he was given by the grace of God, or he composed five hymns in that Mandala 10 of Rig Veda 30 to 34. And he did not resist the rishis, nor he objected. He just went and did his self-effort. He did not fight them or anyway. So the story is of self-effort. And the hymns are regarding, Kavach means armor, which are the qualities needed by us to protect us from our own desires and vasanas, interaction of our senses with the world. Also, his one of his hymns says that we are travelers or yatris, and the final destination of each is Brahman. Only our route is different.
But Kavach means the armor. Kavash means something else. No, it is cha or sha.
In this encyclopedia, is spelled as K-A-V-A-C.
Ha, C is cha. In transliteration, C is cha.
Yeah,
so Kavach Rishi.
The name it was Kavasha.
That's why I'm saying Kavash. Will be two different rishis, Baba. Wo Bhagwat mein dekho kya naam hai. Which is our
Kavashi
hai, and this may be Kavashi hai. Sha or cha
is different. It's like this, but it's A, B, A, S, A. It's S, A, not C.
Sanskrit, dekho Baba. English, why are you watching English? Sanskrit is, so English is also watching. That's what, let's see. Na. Oh, it is. श्लोक वाइज देखो कौन सा श्लोक नंबर है षटकोण का श यू सी कवच इट इज विल बी डिफरेंट ऋषि देन कवच ऋषि विल बी डिफरेंट दिस इज कवश कवश ऋषि अब वो दिक्कत यही होती है when we type in English, no, some other Rishi's name will come because it is Kavasha, Shankarkasha and Kavasha will be SH only in English.
On Google, all this is Kavasha.
Sha.
And in the encyclopedia, it's K-A-V-A-C.
Kavacha is different. That is Kavacha. This is Kavasha. There may not be. That need not be a comprehensive book. It's just a good reference for us. It need not be. So this is K-A-V-A-S-H, is it?
Yeah, in the neck, whatever. And when you said it,
somebody's like Kavash. Okay, so that's good. At least we know something about Kavash Rishi. Some of you who have already presented here, if you have taken exactly from encyclopedia, then that is fine. If you have taken from any other source, then we need a copy of that. So this you can type and send by email. We'll store it somewhere. It will be useful for us.
Can you go to the site from which you
get this? From where did you get this? That also, the source. Anybody else? Who took a Rishi? How many Rishis are left now?
We finished 11.
Devan is mine.
11 is.
Next class will be the last class. Jitne hue, utne hue, uske baad tata bye bye. So otherwise this will go on. Somebody comes, somebody doesn't come.
So I've got a little bit only. This is on Rishi Aarshtishena. Aarshtishena. So I made. Aarshtishena. Aarshtishena. Shena. See, it's there in the 9th verse.
Aarshti.
No, it's Aarshti. Aarshti, that's what I'm saying. Aarshtishena. Aarshtishena. He's the... So this is the Rishi who... The reference is, the Pandavas visited this sage during their life in the forest. His ashrama was midway between Badrashram and Kuber's capital. And he did rigorous tapas in Prathuda Katirtha. So, owing to this tapas, he obtained all the chief Vedas. He gave 3 boons to that Tirtha. So the 3 boons were, those who battle in this Tirtha will get the benefit of Ashwamedha Yajna. Then the second boon was, there will be no fear of snakes in this Tirtha. And the third boon was, a slight effort made here will be rewarded with greater results. So after giving these 3 boons to the river Saraswati, which is Prathuda Katirtha. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing it right, but this is Prathudaka. Is it the same as Saraswati?
Prathudaka Tirtha.
I tried to see if Saraswati had another name which said Praduka Tirtha.
Prathudaka means water. Prithu, maybe the king. Prithu Raja. Or Prithu also means earth.
Prithudaka Tirtha.
One of the names of Kunti is Pritha. And from there comes Parth, Arjun. So Pritha, because she is the daughter of
Prithu.
So it may be connected, I'm just guessing. It may not be. Prithu Udaka Tirtha.
Because here it says, after giving these 3 boons to the river Saraswati, which is Prithudaka Tirtha. So I tried to see whether Saraswati was, whether this was the name, one of the names of Saraswati, but that I couldn't find. So
that's the name of Tirtha. Not the Saraswati. It's like Prayag.
Tirtha.
Ganga is a river. Yamuna is the cleanest flowing there. So like that, Saraswati may be flowing in
Prithakatitha. So what is the current name of this? I couldn't find, but I'll look again. If I find, then I'll send it. This same thing is not there in the this Titha is not there in the encyclopedia. So this is all that is there in the and something similar on the net also. It's almost as common.
In that earlier Kavasha Rishi, you see that Varna system, again that comes, that Varna need not be. Now why did they evict them? Why did they evict him? So, if they evict him, is it wrong?
No, by birth only is...
Without checking with him whether he is a rishi or not. Without seeing his credentials.
That to they check, na, he is a shudra. But knowledge part of it, how do you check means by birth only, na, he will be a shudra. And his life...
If he is judged only by birth, then it could be wrong.
No, no. Yeah, by birth, but you see his life, know what it was. I'm not sure whether they checked, asked him or they would have asked him. They cannot just chuck out somebody. That details may not have been written in that. Is it anything mentioned? Okay, what do, how did they? So that. Because he is known, his life earlier is not a great, yeah, he's wasted. And then one point he transformed. Then he comes, but we don't know whether he, how... He was not a gambler anymore, but he is not even a specific... But he is not even a specific rishi, na? There are certain rituals where rishis only have to sit. They will not even allow ahutis by other people. Even if you see the many yajnas, etc., the ahutis... Some of the ahutis, like ghee ahuti, only the main priest will all do with the ghee. Nobody else can do with ghee. So like that they will have, depends on what yajna they were doing, they will have certain limitations. Ki this is only these people can say, these people can offer ahutis, these people can put samit, these people can put havis, these people can put ghee. Like that they will have. So possibility, I'm just exploring a possibility, that they would have sent him away saying ki not possible. And then when he actually gets knowledge and then they go get him back.
No, but one of the versions is that over there only he points to the body of which Rishi Angiras, and he says that what is the difference between his body and my body. So it's not like he had to do tapas to prove himself.
Both, na. So in both he proved himself. In the second, in the first one also he proved when he says ki atma. That means he has the knowledge, no? Then they accept him ki chalo aajao. The second one, he has to do tapasya, then he proves his knowledge. So either ways, once they find him adequate or he has the required knowledge or eligibility, then he comes, then they take him. Not because their ego has been defeated. Generally we think like that, that now their ego has been defeated, this person proved and now he is accepted. Not like that, eligibility is there, now you come, in that sense. So as she said, you know, the self-effort part of it, anybody can change. Right from a gambler onwards to a rishi, what is the change in this person? And that way though we have accepted, no? Otherwise we will never accept Valmiki Ramayana. Say murderer becomes a rishi and becomes Adikavi, accepted. Vedavyasa himself is born to whom?
Fisherwoman.
Parashar Rishi and Fisherwoman.
So
again, Parashar, so Fisherwoman is what community?
Shudra.
So then the son is accepted, no? In the culture. And then he becomes the compiler of the Veda itself.
But that time the Rishi married
to
a Shudra woman is also,
like,
was a crime.
Not a crime.
He didn't marry
at all.
That talk of Gurudev, yeah, yeah.
He didn't marry. It was a one specific reason why at that point in time he was an astrologer, na, and he Parashar Rishi. And at that point in time he realized that at this time if a son is born, that person will do great for this culture. So instant was the son born, not 9 months delivery and all that stuff.
That's my
So then in that dvipa, And he takes her consent. Lot of people say it's one night stand of a rishi. Hello, it is not a one night stand of a rishi. That is your limited stupid intellect thinking like that. In 9 months time, the child is born. There it is instant the child is born.
And the child
what kind of 1 month? And the child grow is born grown up. And he walks out and he tells Tata, bye bye, I have a lot of work to do. I'm going. So, it's not like that. So, there is a specific purpose. And he did not have lust in his mind. He saw the planetary constellation and he said, now at this point a son is born, will revive the culture. So he takes her consent and he gives her the boon also for the consent. What is the boon? The smell of the fish will go away. Her name is Matsyagandha. And her body has the smell of the fish. He gives her the boon that from now onwards that will disappear.
So it cannot be lost.
Huh?
I'm saying that it cannot be out of lust.
Huh?
Because so much, if he's given her a boon, that's yeah, yeah. Really spelling off. And at that point, only he happened to meet her when he saw this constellation.
Was no, so he is crossing the river. You see how it happens. So the father is eating food, and the father says, you know, I don't want to stop right now. Parashar, he said, I need to go. So the daughter comes forward saying, okay, I will take you. Do you mind? He says, no problem, come. As they are going in the middle of the river, they suddenly, Parashar Rishi says, "Are this constellation is very, very powerful." And they find an island there. So it's not pre-planned. So when he started, it is not that the constellations are already ready. At certain point in time, he would have come to that in the river somewhere in between, and then he suddenly realizes, oh, this is where it is. So he creates a mist around that whole island, and then the son is born. And after that, there is no connection between Parashar Rishi and Satyavati. He goes, he says, this was the son had to be born for the good of the world, now he is born. Son also goes, father also goes, Satyavati is left alone.
But really, Swamiji, what Gurudev says is so right that in terms of we needed to do a Vedant first and only then come to Gurudev.
100%.
Devotion in Vedant is so much easier. Here we can't get ahead because our intellect is so limited to be able to get that head around the story. It just seems so fantastic. And even if the Shraddha is there in the scripture, but it's not devotion for the, you know, what is being spoken of. So Shraddha doesn't go, but devotion does not arise either.
Yeah, when some people Shraddha goes, no?
Yeah,
in some people, because of the skepticism and all, Shraddha also goes. Finally, it will come down to Punya Karma and grace of God. Anybody believes it or not, that's a fact. When Punya Karma is there, then proper knowledge, proper understanding, and then proper application, all the three will happen. If Punya Karma is not there and grace of Bhagwan is not invoked because of that absence of Punya Karma, then one may be born in the house of a realized master also, and still one may be an atheist. So many examples are there of that. So,
since you mentioned it, can you just, because this question has been coming up in a lot of classes and we try to discuss it to the best of our ability, the difference between Punya Karma and grace of God, how we invoke it, because so many times in the commentaries it's clearly written that it's not Punya Karma alone that can invoke the grace of God.
Punya Karma is what? Punya Karma technically is a Punya Karma phala. The result of meritorious action. So because the result is meritorious, so action also we call as meritorious action. So Punya Karma we call. Meaning if you have done good karmas, that the result of those good karmas will be Punya. And what is that good karma? It is technically, I am talking now from scripture standpoint, Ishta and Purta. They are called the source of Punya Karma. Ishta and Purta meaning all the charity that one has done, and all the things that one has done for the good of the society. So, Purta Karma means all these. The building of a school or a hospital or an orphanage or any of those things which are more long-lasting. Ishta will be what you do as a instant thing. So go and donate food, give clothes, give medicine, one-time thing, and this will be a long-term thing, build a well. Purta will be those things. There's a broad classification. Ishta and Purta, the Mundaka Upanishad, it will come in that. So Ishta Purta is what will generally lead to Punya Karma. One category exclusively connected to Dan, Ishta and Purta. Then Punya Karma will come out of good intention to help anybody. Then third Punya Karma will come by doing the duty selflessly. Fourth, when we sacrifice, go through something of discomfort in our life for the well-being of other people, again Punya will get generated. Fifth, remembrance of the Lord and all the religious rites, rituals, temple, visit, yatra, all those things, that also will generate Punya Karma. So all these are, I'm just giving a few, there are many of these which will create Punya Karma. Now those karmas will generate what we call as Punya Karma Phala. That Punya Karma Phala can be utilized in two ways. Either you utilize it for material well-being in this world or in the higher world. So material well-being in this world meaning a good house, money, comforts, body health of the body, all that is Punya Karma getting utilized. Which Janma one will get also is based on Punya Karma only. Till Punya and Papa don't become balanced, human body will not even come. So Punya Karma is utilized in one way for that, and the other way it is utilized, as I said, well-being can be not only here, in the heaven also. So if one wants to enjoy heavenly pleasures, there also Punya. So that is one way, either in heaven or here. Enjoyment, prosperity, well-being, good health, harmony in relationships, all that will come through Punya Karma. Second, it will come through, it can be utilized for satsang. If the jiva demands that I must have self-knowledge, I must have devotion, I must increase in my bhakti, my shraddha must increase, I must have a guru, I want to know who is, what is Brahman, all that when it is there, then Punya is utilized to provide those environments. All this is happening by grace of Bhagwan only, no? Because Bhagwan has given the buddhi to us, number one. Number two, the choice is left on us. How we utilize it is up to us. All these options are given by the Lord. So how to utilize the buddhi, for that knowledge is also given. So overall picture, if you see, grace of God is only making us do everything. That's the biggest picture. But within that, at our level, when we are living at self-effort level, then we have a choice to make. There one has to choose things which will increase the Punya. And which is why all these dana, dharma, all these things are very important. Selflessness in the daily work that I am doing, sacrifice, holding on to values uncompromisingly, all these will create the Punya Karma. Now grace of God is there on everybody. But why is it that some people only get certain environments, and even in those environments some people grasp faster, some people don't? That is because of their Punya Karma only. Ultimately it will come to that, because Punya makes the mind quieter, more sattvic. Then the mind which is more sattvic will develop all these: devotion, vairagya, bhakti, vivek, all this will develop properly. So Punya is utilized in this way. So if we see from grace of God standpoint, yes, God's grace is there on everybody's, every single person, even if that person, like in that case, that person is a gambler. Grace of God is there on the gambler also. Because at some point that person will get out of that, transform, Bhagwan will ensure that they get the right environments and they will move ahead. But that I am talking from the biggest standpoint, the highest standpoint, where everything is grace of God. If we are able to live at that in every aspect, then there is no problem. But at one level below, self-effort level, we are very clear that we are making the choices. Then we have to make the proper choices which will lead to punya karma and avoid what will lead to papa karma. Both are very crucial. Because when I do a wrong action, I will have to face the consequence of it. I cannot escape. Now, why go through that unnecessarily? Generally, we do it because of immediate gratification. And this notion that I will escape. It's okay. At the moment, I don't have to face it. It will come somewhere. Who has seen the next life? All that justification will be there. But when one is suffering, then one starts asking, why me? What wrong did I do? Of course, you did wrong. That's why you are getting this. There is no way that it will be given to you just like that by God partially. It's not happening like that. So, punya has to be done, papa has to be reduced and eliminated. Otherwise, just think about an intellectual like Shankaracharya. Why will he say that? In the very first verse in Sadhana Panchakam itself, he says, papa ugha paridhuyatam bhava sukhe doshonu sandhiyatam. Even in Vivek Chudamani, he says or not, that all these blessings, na, right from Jantunam Narajanma Durlavam, Umswam Tato Viprata, all those 9 blessings will be there. All those will come, how? Shatakoti Janma Sukrutai Punyair Vina Labhyate. In hundreds of crores of human lives, punya. And please remember, punya and papa can be generated or created only in human life. In no other life. Every other yoni is a bhogi yoni. Devata also is bhogi yoni. They will exhaust punya. And the other yonis will be the papa yonis, which will exhaust papa or punya, both. Punya, papa, both will get exhausted in every other yoni, plant, bird, animal, devata. Only in human life one can create punya or papa. Now what all we are doing? No, I don't believe in punya and papa. Very good. Continue. What Shastra is saying is very clear and results are very evidently visible. That why somebody going through some, if you say it is all chance, then to anyway there is no argument. Then to there is nothing to strive for, it's all chance only. Mukti mil gai, to mil gai, nahi mili, to nahi mili, jo karna hai karo. Never ask a question after that, why am I suffering? Chance. Aisa kyun ho gaya? Chance. Then you cannot ask any question.
Swami, how do you explain what is grace?
What is grace? Grace is Bhagwan. Bhagwan is equal to grace. Grace is equal to Bhagwan. Bhagwan's grace, Gurudev used to say, it is like sun and the sunlight. What is the difference between sun and sunlight? Sun is sunlight. Same way, grace is the nature of Bhagwan. So Akhandananji used to say, Bhakta kaun hai, jo Bhagwan ki kripa ki apeksha nahi karta, samiksha karta hai. Don't wait for Bhagwan's grace. See Bhagwan's grace. That the grace of the Lord is already there. My very existence is because of grace of the Lord. The existence of the world is because of grace of the Lord. So that's why that's the highest standpoint. If I am having good thoughts, grace of the Lord. Every single thing happening by grace of Bhagwan only. But our ego doesn't want to accept that. Oh, what is my importance then? Nothing actually. No, I can't accept. Okay, very good. Your self-effort, you do punya, you do papa, you do this, you do that. But you see all these stories, one of the biggest learning from these stories is what? It is already pre-planned. Just that you and I don't know the bigger plan. Like the director has already planned the whole movie. Actor thinks he is making the choices. Who has made the choices? Director has made all the choices.
So to accept that everything he does is grace.
That is, grace will make you accept that. Grace will make me accept that. Grace is equal to Bhagwan.
All negative atmosphere, you see, the positivity is the grace.
Everything,
even negative atmosphere is grace of Bhagwan only.
Yeah,
but remember that whole big picture it is. Na? When Bhagwan tells Arjun that I have already killed these people, even if you don't kill, they are going to be destroyed. You better do your duty and you get all the credit when I am actually done the whole hard work. He says, Tasmad Uttishta Yasholabhaswa. You get up, do your duty and you will get fame. But who has killed them? Maya Eva Nihata Puro Me. I already killed them. So grace is that big picture where nothing, you and I have zero existence or zero, what you call, importance, that's the word. No importance at all. Just think, Bhagavan told Arjun, even without you, rite pitvam na bhavanti sarve. He would have had such a big ego of him, I am Dhanurdhara and Savyasa. And the word he uses there for Arjun is Savyasachin. Nimitta matram bhava, Savyasachi. Meaning you may be ambidextrous, but you are zero. Vedanta is telling us that only, no, finally. Ki, I am nobody. No, but I can't accept that. Okay, take your time. Ultimately, I have to come to that, ki, I am nobody. When I realize I am nobody, what is my understanding? What is my experience? I am everybody. Infinite is my true nature. I am simply holding on to the one little ego, thinking I am this and I did this and I did that and I did not get recognition and I did not get praise. That I only is a problem. No, leave it. Which is what Vedanta is telling us. No, but at this moment I am not ready for it. Yeah, that grace of the Lord, again come to that. He will make us ready. He will give the knowledge. He will
put in more efforts.
Everything He will only do. So should I not do anything? Confusion only full time. Keep doing everything at the moment with the attitude that I have to do my best. And having done it, know that it was destined. That's all. That's the simplest way to handle it right now. While making the choice, if you feel that I am making the choice, then do the best. Keeping selflessness in mind, keeping purity in mind, keeping punya in mind, do the best. And after that, know that I am not the karta, Bhagwan only destined it. No, but aisa ho gaya. So, it had to happen like this only. It was destined like this only. No, in spite of my best effort, it didn't work out. It was supposed to be like this only. After I do my best, that's it called, that's what Gurudev calls it, leave the rest. But he destined it like this. That's all. So no need of guilt, fear, shame, and no need of excitement, elation, anything. Then equanimity will come, then this will happen.